We're looking at a little bit of the energy received from an opponent and exactly how that influences what you do on your Wing Chun. Now, if I'm coming through here and I get a rear hand response here, this tells me something in the moment that I should do to make sure that I can continue on my path. In Rebel Wing Chun, we tend to go to just collapsing like this. If the energy is a past centerline energy, that's where I would go because it's easy. It's going with the flow of the movement, of the mechanical structure that's in our path. So we make an allowance for aiding its movement, and my turn over here makes this a little easier for the elbow to actually seek and find its target. And that's based on receiving that touch. If I come through here and it's a two centerline energy now, I have something that's going through here. For me to try and divert that over here physically when she's got energy going through and out my back, it's not Wing Chun. The process of doing this is antithetical to the moving with the energy, diverting it slightly, that sort of thing. We're trying to, if I get this, it's much easier for me to simply turn this out. My mechanical structure turning on the elbow in and the palm up and out makes for the tonsil, but it makes for opening up this access so that I can then follow through with another strike. There's a lot of ways to train that sensitivity. One of the ways to deal with this is to heighten our sensitivity to pressure and direction. And that's where Wing Chun excels, or it should excel. That's where people who are teaching it should invest a lot of your training in, because that type of sensitivity will help you when you're not able to see, when you're not able to directly focus on what's going on in front. And it could be at night, it could be because you had your eyes sand thrown in them, or they were poked or something else, and all you've got is this tactile response. I'm going to work on a ball and socket principle and a swinging gait principle. Now, swinging gait is really just that. This joint is going to close like that. We're opening the gate and then we're closing it. So it's a swinging gait. The other is the ball and socket. And one way to think about the ball and socket is, if I'm like this and there's a fly on her hair, I'm going to back snatch that fly and come back with it. Because that's kind of, it's when you're training that, a lot of people have a hard time figuring out how to move this. We're working the ball and socket joint up here at the shoulder. So this movement like that, in conjunction with the hinge joint of the elbow, is difficult. A lot of people have a hard time doing that. So one of my methods that I think of is, if there's something up here that I want to snatch, I'll go like this with a backhand snatch like that, grab it, and bringing it around from the inside. So if you think about it like that, you're closer to the actual ball and socket mechanic than not. If I'm giving her energy like that, that's all that's going to happen. Whenever there's this pressure on the back of the hand, we get the swinging gait movement, because that's efficient. That's what we're looking for. We're looking for something that's efficient and gets her used to a skin sensitivity, a heightened sensitivity for pressure and direction, and flowing with that rather than to fight against it. So that's with the backhand response. Now mine on the other end here is, I'm just going to catch it because that's a back fist and I want to make sure it doesn't hit my face. The other is, we're going to go to the inside, and again I will also have that here. Now she's just going to back fist, she's going to come back through just like snatching. However you've got to visualize that, use that. But that's grabbing the fly, grabbing the thing in the back like that is one of the things that works for me. When I'm doing this on the inside like that, the transitional movement that she has to make is not one that goes down. So you'll see some people try to bring that down like that. That's not what we're looking at. We're looking at something that stays along the same line as to the back fist mechanics. If you know anything about the back fist and how to get power on that, you know that it's that snap down of the elbow that precedes it. If my elbow's already down here because I've tried to transition downward, then I have to bring the elbow back up and snap for power. and that's power without the body moving and everything else. So if I'm just using the arm mechanics, that's what I'd be looking at. Higher than you think, bring it up, yes. Bring it up and snap the elbow down. Yes, there you go. Big difference. Higher, snap it down, yes. Those of you who know the back fist is aided by that elbow raising and then snapping down. The process later is our body rotates, the hip drops and curves into the shot, and we put that into place. So that's an extended version of it. But if we don't have the hip involvement, we have to at least have that movement. So if she's doing that to where I get this ball and socket like that, if I come from down here, I don't have the ability to come back and snap without giving her too much information. So if I'm starting it from here and I'm going from this point, it's already up, and then I snap it down. So that's why we would tend to have it on that horizontal plane rather than lowering the elbow joint in that manner. Now, it's completely different if we come up with elbows that are from a different position, which is Rebel Wing Chun and that sort of thing, which we'll go into in another series of videos which I am working on. When I give this energy like that, she tries to stay on that same plane. She'll snap into it and then go through here. So my goal now to help train her is to simply give her stimulus. Remember, always remember, there's no winning at drills. So if that's part of your mentality, I need to win at this, you are in the wrong place. You need to just go competition, get that out of you, and come back to train for fighting. There's a difference, okay? So this isn't fighting, this is training for fighting. There's a huge difference. You don't get to be a good fighter unless you train well to be a fighter. And that's where this is occurring. So here, this is getting enhanced sensitivity. Later, it's just a finger. It might be just the lightest pressure, and she has to respond to just the lightest amount of pressure. And we'll refine that in a second as to how to train that. Now, she's going to now add a checking hand on that. So when I go through here, she will come in on the inside, and she'll turn that one into a lop sal. If I go through here, she checks it with a pock sal. We'll go slow on that again. Go through here, she does a lop sal on top, and then the back fist. Now, the reason that we go a lop sal on top is, there's a good reason. So if she were to go underneath her own arm, this gets trapped much easier. There's always been a debate between my Wing Chun instructors back in the day as to, well, if we were fast enough, you could pull that out and things like that. And it's like, well, mechanically, if you look at that, going up underneath here, the speed at which I could trap that is so much faster than what somebody else can sensibly pull that hand back out and then work a strike out of that. Versus here, where it's on top, if I try to sit here and close it like this, she's already got her mechanical structure makes that much more difficult for me to actually trap successfully because of how my hand even grabs versus here where it's underneath like that. It's a very simple movement of a press down, whereas I then get turned out when she starts rotating. So there's a very big difference on that. So we're always looking at working that on top, just like that. It's a nice lop sal. And then later on, when we work it with the focus mitts, that gives her that nice response. Now, the main thing that you have to watch out for, because some people will, because they want to hit that thing so hard, they tense up prior to. And so when they tense up prior to, that means I'm actually hitting a little harder here on this pressure than would be good for training her sensitivity. So if I'm going through like this and she's responding with that pressure, all of a sudden that becomes the norm. Then when she starts adding power on a hit, now all of a sudden this starts becoming stiffer. Then you've got to back off, go back to this training a little bit so that that becomes the norm, nice and relaxed, nice and relaxed, nice and relaxed, and not moving until I go. There we go. When you get that pressure and you sense that by the time you're doing this and you're giving her that sensitivity, when you start sensing that there is too much feedback on this, meaning she's tensing up, then you've got to go back to the training without the pad till they get used to that again. Relax with it and change up your pattern on this so that it's not a repetitive thing. There we go. Good. Because the way that this works for fighting is your explosiveness in a fight isn't an all tense state, because you cannot, first of all, you can't sustain that. The energy required for doing that is too high. One of the most efficient fighters is someone who can be completely relaxed when the muscles aren't engaged for the action of defending yourself or attacking, versus somebody who's tense all the time because their emotional state is tensing up all their muscles. You look at some of the best fighters in history, Muhammad Ali and so forth, you'll see that they have this relaxed state about them, and then they snap into action. And that snapping into action means that they go from that relaxed muscular state, which is also a mental state, into immediate contraction of the muscles involved for the action alone, and snapping through the strike and then relaxing again. That's key. And you'll find that in the best fighters. They will have that relaxed state, that fluid movement, and then that non-committed, non-concerned state where you see that there is no emotions being played out on their body. Whereas you'll see other people who are very tense, you'll see their emotions immediately are played out on their body. And you'll see that they're very stiff, they're very hard to move in their own attacks or in their own evasions and things like that. And they only last a very short time in a fight because they are consuming so much energy for their rest state versus somebody who's just like calm and relaxed. This is the state that we have to get to recognize pressure and direction the best. If I am all tense, or if she's all tense, that means it requires more force before it gets back to her brain and says, oh wait, there's some pressure here, I should pay attention to that, now I should do something with that. If you are relaxed, you get this sense of as soon as something touches you, you're moving. And that's what we're looking at. So that type of movement has to come into play whenever you get the focus mitt back out. You have to have that relaxed state. And if you do feel a tension, get back to relaxing, snap it off. Do a ragdoll. Ragdolling it is just basically bending forward, letting out all your air and dropping it at the same time. So if she exhales completely, drops down, just completely lets the body relax, shakes it off, ragdolls, and then comes back into a nice calm state, back to that nice, there we go. Oh, you can feel the difference. You can feel it right off the bat. And then later you add power. Right now it's just about having a placeholder for her. So if I don't need this, my hand is a placeholder. People tend to tense up. As soon as you put a focus mitt in there, people will tense up. It's like, oh, action, and now I gotta start doing this. And it's like, relax with it, relax with it. It should be no different than if you're doing this with somebody's hand or the air. She's hitting the air. Okay. But she needs to check my hand though.
I haven't been doing that before.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So checking the hand has to come into play on all of this. Yeah. Tension. There we go. Relax with that.
I have a question about that.
Yes. The key on this checking is really important. If I'm coming through here and she says this hand is cleared, why do I need to do anything? Because I can put this back up. As soon as I go like this, just like that, people in Wing Chun, you know this type of movement. We're in here to this very quickly. So if she doesn't have a checking hand in there, what happens is, yeah, then I get to do my motion and then I check and work on my entry. So off of this, that checking hand is really vital because she keeps that out of the way. So checking hand is always important, because if I were to have a knife in my hand, it's the same mechanic. If I'm coming through here and I'm slashing on the inside because of a distance and whatever else, I'm trying to cut into here, maybe she senses that and gets that hand out of the way in time, or not. Maybe I cut it and then I'm coming back for another strike. If you're going to rely on this being cleared because my hand is coming back here like this, but no interference from your other hand. If this happens to be a blade in your hand, you have a completely different perspective on why I would check that. Our Core JKD training is all about all ranges where a weapon can be used, which means long range, longest range tool, all the way down to grappling. How I formulated Core JKD and our Wing Chun variations are to directly apply to weapons use as well. And everything has to have that mentality, and that's why I build all these dynamic structures for this, is to employ, because this might be a knife. But there was a question about moving in and trapping, so that when this comes into play, so would a person move in and trap? Yes, in application later. Right now, what we're doing is we're training sensitivity on her being able to receive this information and do something with that information as early as possible. That's what we're training. We're not training all the other part. That comes. If you don't get this down, none of the other stuff will matter, because you're plundering through without any ability to understand what's in the way of my path. Do I have to intercept? Do I have to divert to make my defense or attack successful? This is all about the first stages, which is when we don't have peripheral information, we have tactile information. And once we train this to a high level, then all of a sudden, we can go to the next stage, which is now putting power into those shots, getting that relaxation, getting that elbow snap nice and down. There we go. Once we get that down, then we go with eyes closed. See, when we take the eyes out, we no longer have the peripheral information to precede the tactile information and response. When we remove that, you'll notice that there was a difference between all of a sudden the overhead of the visual cortex was dropped, and she went directly into tactile response right now. The motor cortex, we're looking at those sort of things. In this particular case, because I took her eyes out, she now had to adjust to, well, what's the actual thing that's being trained here? The immediacy of tactile response comes into play, and this is really important, because no longer can she rely on a peripheral movement of my arm going through her field of view that tells her, oh, it's going to come here, it's going to go there. Now it's just only the sense of pressure and direction, or lack of pressure, and how she can feel it. This is really important. This is the part where the eyes closed training, including on the ground, will enhance your skill level, I mean, tenfold. It's really incredible how much it helps you. So that's what we're training. When that's all done, then we become more aggressive. Then we have the eyes open and we have that sort of thing. But even here, we train with this eyes closed mentality, so she will trap. She'll actually work the trapping, the lopsaw pulling in more, and moving in on it with successive counters. So she's going to come through and then, like a jutsaw, hold this in, go directly into that. And then this, the better that she is at this response, the faster she'll be at closing that time before she actually employs a strike and is in position for employing that strike. So off of this, bam, she's already moving in, yeah, right there. There you go. So that's the progression. That's something that we work toward. That's something that she has to have down in order to make this work properly. Remember, the lightest touch right now, that's the movement. Getting the mechanics of the structure down. That's what's being trained in this session. The other stuff comes. Well, what is being trained here is your baby steps. If you don't have that down first, you aren't going to be able to run. Got to be able to crawl first. This is crawling. Okay. Go even slower. So that was a little bit on the Wing Chun, how you train some of the energy, and this was the swinging gait and the ball and socket joint mechanic. So if you like that, please thumbs up, and please subscribe if you haven't subscribed. It really helps our channel grow, and it's extremely important, and we very much appreciate it if you did. We put up some new stuff for the sparring sessions for our knife work. There's more to come on our Patreon channel. And if you check that out, like I said, $1 a month will get you some great stuff. We're still running the special till the next few days for the Patreon at $20. You will get the CJKDmember.com access to all of our curriculum material as well, which is normally like $40. So it's like half price. It's really a huge discount, and we're running that because there's tremendous interest in it, and I want to make it available for this time for those people. So once you purchase it at that price, you're grandfathered in. So take advantage of it while you can. You also get the new, after so many months, you get our regular videos that are sale videos at greatly discounted or free. So that is also something that comes into play. That is a benefit that our group leaders and the people who are on the access for the CJKDmember.com site get. There are a lot of benefits, including I will review your training tapes and so forth and help you get to another level in your training, to help you with the curriculum itself, so you'll have access to email directly with me. Also our chat session, we also have a discussion group on there for our group leaders. Any questions, just put them in the comments below and we will look them over. And thank you. Good luck in your training.